Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Conservative Heartland, a political history of the post-war American Midwest, edited by John K. Lauck and Catherine McNicol Stock, narrated by Mike Chamberlain and Teri Schnaubelt. Publisher's Note: This audiobook refers to figures and tables included in the print and ebook editions of the book. Introduction. Finding the Deeper Conservatism of the American Midwest. John K. Lauck and Catherine McNicol Stock. Only 3 days had passed since Donald Trump had won the 2016 presidential election, but David Plouffe, the manager of Barack Obama's campaign in 2008, already knew what Democratic Party leaders had gotten wrong. They had taken the Midwest for granted. Even though support for Obama had dwindled between 2008 and 2012, Plouffe believed that the region's blue wall of Democratic-leaning states would hold for Hillary Clinton in 2016. Plouffe and others had actually mocked Republicans for thinking they could change the map in the Midwest. As Trump's operatives flew around in Pennsylvania and Michigan, Plouffe wrote in the New York Times, many people, including me, ridiculed them as aimlessly and amateurishly wasting time and resources. But they saw something and committed to a strategy few even in the Republican Party thought would work. They challenged conventional wisdom and were proved right. After the 2016 election, it seemed unlikely that any future Democratic candidate for president would fail to visit Wisconsin, as the Clinton campaign famously had, ever again. Plouffe's analysis of the Republican upset was dead on, except for one thing. If there ever had been a Democratic blue wall in the Midwest, it had been built quite recently and with flimsy materials. In the lead-up to the 2016 election, pundits from both sides warned that Democrats should not assume their support in the region was secure. The conservative Merrill Matthews, for example, wondered how anyone on the left could call the Midwest a liberal region when voters had recently elected conservative governors like Scott Walker and Mike Pence, and nearly all state legislatures were dominated by Republicans. No less a liberal than 538's founder Nate Silver explained that if there ever had been a blue wall, it had not been built until 1992, when Democrats had begun a pretty good run. But, he countered, it doesn't sound so impressive to instead say Democrats have won 5 of the 12 elections since 1968. The facts bear Silver out. Democrats had performed well in the Midwest between 1992 and 2012, with Bill Clinton and Barack Obama winning Michigan, Wisconsin, Ohio, Iowa, and Illinois twice. In that same period, however, Republicans had made strong showings. George W. Bush won Ohio, Indiana, Missouri, Nebraska, Kansas, and North and South Dakota twice, and Iowa once. In earlier election cycles, the Republicans had been even more competitive. Reagan had won every Midwestern state except Minnesota in both 1980 and 1984. Nixon and Eisenhower also boasted sweeping wins in the region. The Republican victory in 2016 was hardly a fluke. Midwestern conservatives had expressed ideas, supported leaders, and built organizations and national prominence throughout the 20th century. It was Midwestern Republicans, for example, who had critiqued the New Deal and its empowerment of the federal bureaucracy most vociferously. In the 1930s and 1940s, William Allen White of Kansas and Senator Arthur Vandenberg of Michigan embraced a civic-minded establishment republicanism that shaped the Eisenhower-era Republican Party of the 1950s. Taftite Midwestern conservatives, the Chicago Tribune, the publisher Henry Regnery, and prominent Midwestern senators such as Everett Dirksen of Illinois and Robert Taft of Ohio, represented another strand of Midwestern conservatism. During the era of World War II, the University of Chicago became a site of conservative thought with the blossoming of its Great Books and Classical Studies program, launched by Ohioan Robert Hutchins, and the UC also brought political philosopher Leo Strauss to Chicago to join market economists such as Friedrich Hayek and Milton Friedman. The writings of Russell Kirk of Macosta, Michigan, made him the godfather of traditional conservative thought in the 1950s. Kirk mentored Illinoisan R. Emmett Tyrrell Jr., who would go on to publish a conservative paper for students at Indiana University. Kirk and Tyrrell worked with the newly organized Young Americans for Freedom, which was also largely led by young Midwesterners. Together, these Midwesterners contributed institutions, ideas, and organizing strategies that led to the most important milestone of conservatism in the 20th century, the 1980 election of Ronald Reagan, himself a son of the Midwest, raised in Dixon, Illinois. This volume seeks to remind political commentators, scholars, and the public of these varied and nationally significant traditions of conservatism in the Midwest. By doing so, it also joins the collective effort to revive Midwestern history as a whole. During the early 20th century, the Midwest was home to a robust movement of regional historians who diligently chronicled their region. In the years after World War II, however, this movement collapsed, and the historical study of the Midwest as a region went into eclipse. Most political and cultural historians who have examined places in the Midwest have focused narrowly on urban areas such as Detroit, Chicago, and Milwaukee, and on mid-century Democratic politicians such as Hubert Humphrey, George McGovern, and Richard Daley. Given the dearth of knowledge about the conservative Midwest and the demise of the field of Midwestern history as a whole, it is no wonder that many analysts were shocked at the election returns in 2016. A revived Midwestern history, with a focus on the region's varied social, cultural, economic, geographic, and political landscapes, can help us understand all of American culture more completely. Grounding the history of conservatism in the Midwest also provides a fuller understanding of post-war conservatism itself, especially the historic transition from everyday or establishment conservatism of the Eisenhower years to the new conservatism of the Nixon, Reagan, Bush era. Until the mid-1990s, academic historians largely ignored the history of modern conservatism altogether. Since then, it has become a burgeoning subfield, but it remains dominated by studies of the American South, the Southwest, and California. It is easy to understand why this has been the case, as historic developments in those regions created natural starting places for both the new conservative movement and initial research. As Lisa McGurr and others relate, the development of a large defense industry in Orange County and other parts of Southern California spurred anti-communism and anti-statism on the West Coast. With McGurr, Michelle Nickerson has shown that suburban white women often led these local movements before becoming involved in larger political campaigns like those for Goldwater and Nixon. Historians of the American South, such as Darren Dochuk, Bethany Morton, and Kevin Cruz, have also explored the cultural and political responses of whites to the African-American freedom movement and other demands for social change, including the shift of many white voters from the Democratic to the Republican Party and the politicization of Christian conservatives. Spreading out from the traditional Cotton South, historians have also explored the growth of conservatism and suburbanization in the Sunbelt as a whole. Historians, including Timothy Lombardo, have also turned their attention to post-war conservatism in the urban Northeast, publishing studies of Boston, Brooklyn, and Philadelphia. This book seeks to move the story to the Midwest. Its 17 essays, representing work on 9 different states, exploring the ideas, issues, leaders, geographies, and controversies that defined the evolution of conservatism in the post-war years. They remind us that any conservative victory in the Midwest was not an anomaly, but part of a long-standing tradition of competitive regional politics. At the same time, however, they do not suggest that the Midwest is and always has been a uniformly conservative region. Instead, while emphasizing conservatism, they help us to see that Midwestern political traditions have always been spirited, varied, and evolving. At present, much of the Midwest, geographically speaking, remains red, but is also punctuated with islands of blue, even in states that remain Democratic-leaning. Minnesota, a blue state, for example, includes strands of conservative thought and organization both within the dominant Twin Cities area and outstate. By contrast, in states such as the Dakotas, Kansas, and Nebraska, conservatism has become the dominant political discourse, but still must contend with vibrant traditions of progressive and populist agrarianism. The Midwestern conservative tradition exists alongside a long progressive streak, which makes the Midwest a politically competitive region, perhaps the last battleground left in the country. Each essay in this volume explores a discrete episode in the history of conservatism in the post-war Midwest, from the defeat of Republican women in Michigan who supported abortion rights, to the privately funded construction of a $100 million hockey rink in Grand Forks, North Dakota, complete with more than 3,000 representations of the controversial Fighting Sioux mascot. Individually, each essay adds to what we know about the recent history of conservatism in the Midwest, but collectively, they teach us even more. Politics, even in the smallest places, happens not in a vacuum, but in the broader context of events and trends that variously impact people and communities. When heard together, then, the essays highlight historical developments, at once interrelated, mutually reinforcing, and distinct, that changed the focus of mid-century conservatism in the Midwest from its traditional pro-business agenda and moderate view of the role of the government to the conservatism of recent decades, with its focus on cultural issues, reducing the size of the government, cutting taxes, and supporting the military. The essays also note the changing face of conservatism, explaining how white, working-class, Catholic, and ethnic voters shifted from the Roosevelt to the Reagan coalitions. Before discussing post-war developments in the region, some precedents should be noted. Conservative instincts did not suddenly materialize in 1945. The Midwest was settled after the American Revolution, and the region embraced, from the beginning, a tradition of democratic governance, private property, and open markets. No region in the world, Andrew Caton said of the Midwest, saw a more unfettered and less contested expansion of capitalist enterprise in the 19th and 20th centuries. James Madison called the Midwest one of the greatest monuments to capitalism the world has ever seen. The agricultural and industrial economies of the Midwest boomed during the 19th century. As the Midwest grew economically stronger, its regional identity deepened. As the Midwest emerged as a recognizable and distinct region in the late 19th century, for example, it began to grow its own institutions and develop its own voices and generally assert some regional independence. As a stronger Midwestern regionalism developed, so did more frictions with the dominant metropoles of the East. These longer-term traditions of market economics and resistance to coastal domination help to explain the post-war assertions of regional identity and independence and a skepticism of coastal cities, large government, and liberal activism. This deeper history helps highlight four major developments that spurred conservatism in the Midwest in the post-war era. The first was the gradual strengthening of political and cultural liberalism in the country during the New Deal and in the aftermath of World War II. At mid-century, the power of organized labor was at its zenith. Likewise, in the early 1960s, a new generation, the New Left, pushed for aggressive reforms, advancing anti-poverty initiatives, efforts to reform the criminal justice system, and anti-war, anti-nuclear, feminist, gay rights, and environmental movements. At the same time, the Kennedy and Johnson administrations were increasingly activist, and the Supreme Court made a number of left-leaning decisions, including those that ensured rights to accused criminals, legalized contraception and abortion, and banned prayer in school. As the essays in this volume demonstrate, none of these events went unnoticed in the Midwest. In Wisconsin, for example, when a coalition of liberal leaders and groups advocated abolishing prisons, conservatives responded with a concerted effort to strengthen criminal statutes and to crack down on drug use, part of a much larger effort to promote law and order. In Indiana, the performative protests of leftist student radicals sparked criticism from conservative students and the creation of conservative organizations and magazines at Indiana University. When South Dakota Senator George McGovern, son of a conservative Methodist minister, emerged as the face of the new politics and the campus left, voters in his home state began to wonder if he still reflected South Dakota thinking. In 1980, they decided that he did not. McGovern's defeat in his bid for re-election to the U.S. Senate became an exclamation point on the coming of Reagan's conservative revolution and symbolic of the rejection of liberalism in the Midwest in the wake of the 1960s. While the story of a backlash to an increasingly activist liberalism is a national one, specific demographic characteristics gave it a unique quality and momentum in the Midwest. Nearly all states in the region had long been home to large ethnic working-class communities and large concentrations of Catholics. Most of these men and women were dutiful members of the Roosevelt Coalition, and many were members of powerful unions, including the famous United Auto Workers Union. But these allegiances weakened as the century unfolded. A cloud of corruption settled over union activities during the 1950s, and, combined with business efforts to promote right-to-work laws, labor's strength gradually diminished. Conservative working-class Democrats were always attracted to politicians who called for a return to law and order and an end to protests and violence, both in their communities and in the country at large. Charlie Stenvig, an upstart outsider, political independent, and former policeman, rode these sentiments and a law and order platform to victory and served as mayor of Minneapolis from 1969 to 1973 and 1976 to 1978. In South Dakota, another political outsider, Bill Janklow, rose to prominence and the governor's office by promoting law and order and a tough stance against the protests and violence of the American Indian movement. On the northern peninsula of Michigan, State Representative Dominic Jacobetti, a Democrat, organized a separatist campaign so that rural counties would not be beholden to downstate urban problems and priorities, particularly environmental regulation. These events in urban Minneapolis and South Dakota and the upper peninsula of Michigan show how working-class voters began to embrace conservative anti-crime messages and calls for less government regulation, a trend that has continued. After the 2016 election, the chair of the Democratic Party in Mahoning County, Ohio, where Youngstown is located, said, "At one time, a guy who showered after work and not before used to be reliably blue, and I'm not sure they are anymore." A second factor in the transition to a new Midwestern conservatism was growing Catholic support for the movement. In an early sign of the coming disjuncture between Catholics and the Democratic Party, for example, during the 1950s, many Catholic intellectuals joined the conservative cause. So did Clarence Mannion, the dean of the University of Notre Dame Law School, who developed a prominent national radio show. By the 1960s, many working and middle-class Catholics left the Democratic Party over cultural issues such as abortion. Two of the most influential conservative activists of this era, Phyllis Schlafly of St. Louis and Paul Weyrich of Racine, Wisconsin, were Catholics from the region. In Michigan, as Anne Marie Wambeka demonstrates, the staunchest opponents of abortion were working-class Catholic Democrats who would soon become Republicans. The Democrats' hemorrhaging of urban Catholic voters became particularly noticeable during McGovern's 1972 candidacy for president. Mike Royko, the famed Chicago Tribune columnist, complained that the 59-member Illinois delegation to the 1972 Democratic Convention only had one Italian and three Poles. Ascendant liberals like McGovern, he said, had disenfranchised Chicago's white ethnic Democrats, who were almost uniformly Catholic. Many white Midwestern Protestants also moved right. In the immediate aftermath of World War II, Republicans across the country were known for their frequent church attendance. In the Midwest, many belonged to the increasingly liberal and socially activist mainline Protestant denominations, whose pews were filled with businessmen, professionals, and their families. But the rise of popular evangelical leaders with a national media presence and a strong anti-communist ideology, like Billy Graham, who launched his career as president of Northwestern Bible College in Minneapolis from 1948 to 1952, attracted Midwestern Protestants to evangelical ideas, even at a time when there were not many evangelical congregations in the region. In the 1960s, 1970s, and 1980s, in response to the cultural liberalism of the era, Midwesterners left their former congregations, built their own churches, hired pastors who emphasized Bible-based teachings and personal salvation, and became more involved in organizations such as Iowa's Conservative Coalition. These conservative Protestants contributed to the defeat of prominent Midwestern Democratic senators such as Dick Clark, Iowa, Birch Bayh, Indiana, Gaylord Nelson, Wisconsin, and George McGovern, South Dakota, in 1978 and 1980. In perhaps the most surprising turn of events in a region where anti-Catholicism persisted at least until the 1960 election, evangelical Protestants increasingly worked with Catholics to promote an agenda of cultural conservatism. Midwestern Catholic Congressman Henry Hyde of Illinois, a product of a Democratic family, became a nationally known opponent of abortion as a Republican. Hyde would speak to audiences during the 1970s and say, "I stand before you, a 652-month-old fetus." A third factor that contributed to the post-war conservative resurgence, along with rising liberalism and the ecumenical activism of conservative Christians, was the drastically changing economic climate of the post-war era. By the mid-1950s, the heyday of both the industrial and the agricultural Midwest had nearly peaked, and as early as 1950, some Midwestern states experienced decreases in population and numbers of electoral college votes. The manufacturing sector, including the steel and automobile industries, would lose hundreds of thousands of jobs to automation and to southern states or offshore locations. Rust Belt refugees followed, in search of employment, to the Sunbelt cities of Houston, Dallas, and Phoenix, and contributed to the erosion of once powerful labor unions in the Midwest. Republican governors, including Ed Schaefer in North Dakota, James Rhodes in Ohio, Bill Janklow in South Dakota, and Mitch Daniels in Indiana, sought to diversify their economies through corporate investment, even if it meant offering special deals to corporations, even Japanese automobile corporations, they had never considered doing business with before. Farmers and farm groups still fought to preserve an older agrarian way of life, but technological changes in farming and economic struggles caused more and more people to leave the farm. The demise or decline of prominent farm organizations, such as the National Farmers Organization and the National Farmers Union, and the increasing size and business orientation of the remaining farms has made the countryside more conservative, especially in the area of culture. For a century, cosmopolitans have seen the rural and small-town Midwest as provincial, home to a village mind, and thus a source of resistance to modern liberalism and of continuing political and cultural frictions. These tensions periodically became manifest, such as the moment a small town in Minnesota fought back against a European reporter who attempted to smear the town as backward and retrograde. Changing racial demographics and the lived experience of both whites and people of color in the region was the fourth factor that influenced the new conservatism in the Midwest. While many African Americans had stayed loyal to the party of Lincoln through mid-century, the new conservatives of the 1970s and 1980s, in the Midwest, as throughout the country, were largely white. A few were attracted to, or at the very least not repelled by, the open racial hostility of conservative candidates like George Wallace. And yet the history of race in the Midwest has never been a simple carbon copy of the history of race in other regions, and particularly not of the Jim Crow South. The Midwest was unique because the Northwest Ordinance, the original charter for the region, had abolished slavery. The Republican Party was also born in the Midwest in the 1850s as an anti-slavery party, and its rapid growth inflamed regional tensions, led to the election of the first GOP president in 1860, precipitated the Civil War, and caused a deep divergence between the Midwest and South after the war. For much of the 20th century, Midwesterners did not think they shared much in common with Southerners, and electoral patterns reflected it. Even the most conservative states in the region rarely voted in lockstep with their Southern neighbors. In a remarkable display of regional consensus, only one senator from the Midwest, Burke Hickenlooper of Iowa, voted against the Civil Rights Act of 1964. Many African Americans also recognized that race relations in the Midwest were much better than in the South. Between 1910 and 1970, the children and grandchildren of former slaves and their children streamed out of the South and into Midwestern cities such as Chicago, Detroit, and Milwaukee. Richard Wright famously fled Mississippi for Chicago and was spellbound by his newfound freedoms. In one of Wright's most memorable lines in his autobiography, he wrote about how Southern blacks would take a part of the South to transplant in alien soil in the North to see if it could grow differently, if it could drink of new and cool rains, bend in strange winds, respond to the warmth of other suns, and perhaps to bloom. Isabel Wilkerson would adopt these lines for her prize-winning account of the Great Migration, The Warmth of Other Suns, which does much to emphasize the stark transition from South to North and to describe the celebrations of blacks once they crossed the Ohio River into the North. As Wright recognized, the central purpose of the migration was to flee from one American region to another, an exodus premised on a deep commitment to a vision of regional differences and driven by Northern fever and a corresponding hatred of the South. Southern blacks routinely recounted the horrors of the Jim Crow South as a basis for leaving. They wanted to go anywhere North, anywhere but the South, and were drawn by the powerful image of the North as the promised land. They saw Midwestern cities as a new world. Wright described the trek as going to another country. As Wilkerson has explained, they hopefully moved into a new world called the Midwest, a foreign region of essentially another world. After crossing the Ohio River, black migrants from Mississippi stopped and held solemn ceremonies and rejoiced, and others embraced their new freedoms by sitting next to white people on the train. When a Chicago commission surveyed Southern black migrants and asked why they left, they cited the better conditions in Chicago and the need to get away from the South. Black migrants felt like Wright, who declared, "We'd rather be a lamppost in Chicago than the president of Dixie." Wright was immediately struck by the absence of racial fear in Chicago and noticed how blacks and whites sat together on streetcars with nobody noticing, as though this were a normal thing to do. Wright recorded that the white men seem impersonal and their very neutrality reassures us. Oh, sweet welcome indifference! Ida Mae Brandon Gladney, a migrant who left Chickasaw County, Mississippi, and was profiled by Wilkerson, said Chicago looked like heaven to me then. Gladney was following a common interregional migration stream that took blacks like Richard Wright and his family from Mississippi, Louisiana, and Alabama to Midwestern cities such as Chicago, Detroit, and Cleveland. Blacks from coastal states, in another regional dynamic, tended to move to New York and Philadelphia. The regional divide was immediately visible to Southern black migrants, and their vision of Canaan in the Midwest put into sharper focus the tyranny of Egypt back in the South. In Chicago, for example, Blacks and whites largely went to the same parks, theaters, racetracks, and bars, and played together on baseball teams, or played each other in front of interracial crowds, used the same YMCA, went to the same African-American doctors, and even intermarried. Many black clubs, lodges, and churches existed, as did four black newspapers. Chicago housing was much better than the shacks of the South. Blacks could bring lawsuits to enforce their rights under the Illinois Civil Rights Act, and, perhaps most shocking of all for recent black migrants from the South, they could vote in elections and participate actively in politics. Despite a more recent and less hopeful history, as Elizabeth Dale has noted, there was a time when African Americans still held some hope for an integrated existence in Chicago. Similar conditions and hopes could be found in the Midwest beyond the black metropolis of Chicago. The involvement of African Americans in the politics of Minnesota, for example, also provided a dramatic contrast to the exclusion of blacks from the political process in the Jim Crow South. Similarly, while Southern whites were cresting their campaign for stringent segregation during the late 19th century, Leslie Fischel has explained, Wisconsin was broadening African-American rights by passing a Civil Rights Act, and African-Americans were actively working to achieve parity with whites. Iowans also passed multiple civil rights bills, including by popular vote, and made their state one of the most progressive in civil equality for blacks. These positive steps toward racial equality in the Midwest explain how a young black woman could grow up in Minnesota and not recall facing any racial hostility as a child, and then discover the extreme humiliations of segregation after taking a job in Mississippi, an experience Richard Wright knew too well. The murder of the young Chicagoan Emmett Till in Mississippi in 1955 and the resulting media coverage also highlighted the deep regional divide between the treatment of blacks in the Midwest and the South, and revealed a high level of Midwestern anger towards Southern segregation and anti-black violence. The deep partisan divisions in Congress between Southern Democrats and Northern Republicans over the issue of civil rights further accentuated these regional differences. Many African Americans found success in the Midwest and were buoyed by notions of ethnic pluralism that were first developed in the region, by Midwestern creations such as human relations commissions, which were designed to promote racial peace in urban areas, by local community leaders who worked to promote racial peace, and by Midwestern universities, which welcomed African American players into the ranks of the Big Ten while they remained excluded from college sports in the South. Many Midwestern Republicans supported these efforts, and conservatives in the region tended to focus on issues other than race as they gained traction in the 1970s. And yet the Midwest was not heaven, where racism and discrimination did not exist. Nor did the new conservative candidates, nearly all of whom were white, prioritize racial equality in their political platforms, as Eisenhower-era politicians largely had. On the contrary, whites in the Midwest, like other whites in other regions of the United States, at once lived, as Toni Morrison puts it, in the shadow of the African, and, as Roxanne Dunbar-Ortiz explains, under the governing structures of a constitution that could support racial inequality even where slavery was outlawed. White people in much of the Midwest had also long accepted and even celebrated the shared cultural memory of the settlement of the Midwest and the dispossession of the original inhabitants of the region. Almost all whites in the Midwest lived on land previously held by Native people. Beginning in the 1950s, Midwesterners in Chicago, Detroit, Cleveland, and Minneapolis lived near large numbers of Native people too, as young Native men and women relocated to urban areas from their reservations. Thus, while the Midwest was a world away from the South, some white Midwesterners were prepared to protect their cultural and political power and had experience doing so. In the early decades of the Great Migration, some of the bloodiest rioting took place in Chicago, Omaha, and East St. Louis, when white citizens believed blacks had, in various ways, overstepped their place in the community or were competing for scarce post-war jobs. In 1919, for example, a 17-year-old boy swam across an informal boundary between the white and black beaches on Lake Michigan. Whites threw rocks at him until he drowned, but police refused to arrest them. The ensuing riot raged for over a week. As some of our essayists demonstrate, in the years after World War II, white Midwesterners found new ways to control the spaces, rights, and bodies of their non-white neighbors. In Illinois, for example, redlining, poor access to credit, and employment discrimination kept many African Americans in urban neighborhoods, particularly on the south side of Chicago, while whites took flight to the suburbs to the west and south of the city. Some of the whites who stayed behind, such as the residents of the Trumbull Park area of Chicago, resisted the migration of African Americans into their neighborhood. The reapportionment struggle in the Illinois legislature also made black political representation more difficult. Similar restrictions on housing and political representation developed in Detroit and Milwaukee. In Minneapolis, zoning for single-resident homes only tended to segregate neighborhoods by both race and class. At the same time, white voters pressed for increased numbers of police, new prisons, and tougher penalties for lawbreakers. Historian Gary Gerstle has suggested that in some Midwestern cities, the migration of white Southerners to the industrial Midwest amplified these racial conflicts. It is also possible that the inverse, the migration of white Midwesterners to Southern California, may have influenced new conservatives in the early 1960s to prioritize anti-communism and libertarian issues over racial issues. Whatever demographic shifts have occurred in recent decades, however, race relations continues to be a multifaceted and complex problem in the Midwest, perhaps in part because it was the one region, at least initially, where racial inequalities were not supposed to exist. One of the goals of this volume is, by looking at specific people, places, and events, rather than relying on generalizations, to explore how white conservatives understood and expressed their role in society, particularly in the political sphere. Underscoring and amplifying the ethnic, religious, economic, and racial developments in the Midwest was its unique geography, a geography both physical and cultural that has long helped to make the region a true political battleground. Unlike the far West, where sprawling urban oases are surrounded by vast desert and forest lands, the small and large cities of the Midwest are surrounded by productive farmland, towns of all sizes, and suburbs. Through much of the post-war period in the Midwest, the basic New Deal pattern remained fixed: Democratic cities against GOP suburbs and countryside. As many of these essays reveal, the political competition between urban and outstate or downstate counties has remained a core element of Midwestern politics, explaining, for example, the remarkable difference between voting patterns in Rochester, Minnesota, and Fargo, North Dakota, and those of rural areas less than 30 minutes away. The electoral heft of urban metros vis-a-vis rural areas explains how Trump could win 91 of Illinois' 102 counties and 78 of Minnesota's 87 counties and still lose the states. In previous decades, some rural Midwesterners allied themselves with agrarian movements on the left. Since the 1970s, they, like other whites in the region, and for many of the same reasons, have moved to the right. Indicative of this transition, in 2000, the town of Wyoming, Iowa, was literally equally split between votes for George W. Bush and Al Gore, 2,450 votes each, though in 2016, the majority voted for Trump. The small town itself, hardly large enough for many maps, was a battleground, a representation of the contest of ideas at the heart of American politics and the unique political culture of the region as a whole. One place where the social and geographic variation of the Midwest was particularly visible was at the region's universities and colleges. And this was never more true than in the 1960s and 1970s, when some campuses became equated with social protest and were met with strong police responses, while other campuses, particularly land-grant colleges in more rural towns, were known for much quieter and conservative atmospheres. The Midwest's most activist campus was the University of Wisconsin in Madison, a fact influenced by its high number of students from New York, who historian Martin Levin argues outmaneuvered a strong contingent of right-leaning students. In 1970, a radical group called the New Year's Gang firebombed several locations in Madison, as well as the Army Math Research Center, where a doctoral student in physics was killed. The University of Michigan was also well known for its activist students. There, Todd Gitlin, also from New York, and others in the Students for a Democratic Society, SDS, drafted the Port Huron Statement in 1962. It came to be seen as the manifesto of the New Left. While few would put the University of Kansas and Kansas State University on the list of most radical campuses, they were war-weary enough to welcome Robert F. Kennedy shortly after he declared his candidacy for president in 1968. At Kansas State, Kennedy opened with a quotation from William Allen White and urged students to reject consumerism and join his campaign to combat poverty and end the war. After the positive response, a photographer for Lauck shouted, "This is Kansas, effing Kansas. He's going all the effing way." The reason that Kennedy and his campaign were nervous about speaking at Kansas State and that the Lauck photographer was so surprised at the reaction to Kennedy was the fear of a tepid response and perhaps open rejection, a fear not without foundation. Midwestern campuses could be quite conservative. Many members of the communities surrounding Midwestern campuses, as well as university administrators and conservative students, resented the campus upheavals. The willingness of authorities to quell student protesters in the Midwest is, of course, best illustrated by the case of Kent State University in Ohio. Some student activists complained that many students, as a leader of SDS at Indiana University complained, were worse than apathetic. At Ohio State University, students accepted the rules of conduct established by their elders. Most students at smaller schools in rural areas, sometimes dubbed the football and dairy colleges, maintained a calmer atmosphere and organized few protests. General Beadle State Teachers College in South Dakota, now Dakota State University, was so calm that President Nixon felt comfortable attending the opening of the Carl Munt Library there in 1969 to denounce campus radicals. When a protester lifted an anti-war sign, he was dragged down by his hair by other students and shown the exit. With the exceptions of places such as Madison and Ann Arbor, where protests generated much criticism from conservatives and fueled anti-liberal sentiments, Midwestern colleges remained less radical than their more celebrated coastal brethren, such as the University of California at Berkeley and Columbia University. Although Midwestern campuses were not as active as some of their high-profile counterparts on the coasts, the air of dissent and the countercultural mood did give rise to new attitudes toward sexual mores. These attitudes propelled the critiques of licentiousness by social conservatives during the 1960s and 1970s, and created sites of post-war cultural conflict. In Minneapolis, for example, a fight broke out over pornographic bookstores that united parts of the left and right and advocates of protecting local neighborhoods. More generally, Minneapolis became a site of an active gay community and a gay rights movement that attracted many young people from surrounding rural areas. So did Chicago. Kansas also saw the emergence of a less urban but similarly active gay community. Some scholars have broken long-standing conventions by highlighting how much more tolerant the rural Midwest was of gay community members than many observers would have assumed. The most widely publicized public campaigns related to gay rights became public referenda on a gay marriage beginning in the early 21st century, a process that included the Iowa Supreme Court's legislation of gay marriage in 2009. This history, which may defy conventional wisdom for some listeners, in some ways befits the region's political traditions. Prominent liberals from the Midwest, such as Hubert Humphrey, George McGovern, and Paul Simon, were always thought of as decent and benevolent. McGovern, in fact, was the first major political leader in the country to promote gay rights. Shirley MacLaine thought McGovern failed so badly during his presidential run, in part because he was too nice. He seemed uncomfortable with people who were overt or aggressive. Prominent Republican leaders of this era, such as Everett Dirksen, Gerald Ford, Robert Dole, Robert Michael, and Paul Ryan, are also thought to be polite and kind. The brashness associated with prominent political leaders of the post-war era, such as Barry Goldwater, George Wallace, and Newt Gingrich, is especially un-Midwestern. By far, Donald Trump's worst region during the 2016 primary season was the Midwest, where he lost contests in Iowa, Minnesota, Wisconsin, Nebraska, Kansas, and Ohio. These results point to the persistence of what might be called an everyday conservatism in the Midwest, characterized by neighborliness, a middle American, Harding-esque normalcy, a balanced budget ethos and pragmatism that emanates from, say, the Peoria Chamber of Commerce, a vital centerness that was first articulated by Ohioan-turned-Iowan Arthur Schlesinger Jr., the palpable levels of social capital that Ohioan Robert Putnam has found in Midwestern towns, a grounded nostalgia for a past that was very real, the common sense of Paul Harvey's commentaries broadcast out of Chicago, the memories that shaped the Missourian Walt Disney's visions of small-town Midwestern main streets and Illinoisan Ronald Reagan's memories of Dixon, and the simple rhythms of the great, ordinary, Lawrence Welkish mass of Americans. It is the reluctance to be, as Garrison Keillor once said, a $10 haircut on a 50-cent head. One Iowa woman, when reflecting on her childhood and her Christian church and her opposition to welfare programs, did not think of her involvement in politics as some grand ideological choice. I suppose it would be considered pretty political, but it made so much sense because, to me, it was just the way we were all trained up to live. These qualities of everyday Midwestern conservatism are difficult to pin down, but they routinely emerge and remain a feature of the region's political culture and deserve more study. Our exploration of Midwestern politics is done with an urgency based in the simple fact that the Midwest may be the only true regional battleground that remains in American politics, and that American life depends on Americans being willing to come out from their ideological corners and engage with each other. Demographers have shown that Americans have begun to live farther and farther away from people who disagree with them politically, adding to the entrenched nature of the fault lines in society and the anger they have produced. For many Midwesterners, in places like Wyoming, Iowa, and Fergus Falls, Minnesota, however, this is not the case. For them, to talk to someone in the opposing party might mean a simple walk to the neighbor's house. In fact, most Midwestern states have retained the political and cultural diversity of ideas and experiences that others consider artifacts of the past. The contentious coexistence of strong and populous urban as well as outstate regions and leaders, the significant and growing group of independent voters who may vote the candidate more than the party, the history of leaders on both sides of the aisle whose moderate views, pragmatism, and charisma have long allowed them to create bipartisan alliances. For conservatives, the main focus of this volume, the reality of this competitive political environment has required the development of a movement agile enough to change, compromise, and even reorganize when needed. In the interest of clarity, the matter of terminology should be addressed before delving into this book. In our view, along with many historians and political theorists, the United States was founded as a liberal nation. That is to say, by the standards of European political thought and practice during the 18th century, which was still defined by monarchies and the divine right of kings, the United States broke free by means of a revolution and launched a liberal nation. It embraced individual rights, the rule of law, a written constitution, a separation of church and state, open markets, limited government, a moral order largely understood through the teachings of the Judeo-Christian tradition, and strains of the old classical republicanism of Greece and Rome. When Lewis Hartz of Omaha discussed the American liberal tradition dating back to the American founding, this is what he meant. When some historians say there is no conservative tradition in the United States, they mean that there is no old European conservatism, one of monarchical privilege, social hierarchies, a melding of the central state and an official religion, an aristocracy, and government control over economic functions. The political lexicon changed significantly in the 20th century, and the new meanings that emerged are the ones largely used today. During the early 20th century, some reformers who sought to build stronger government regulatory structures to manage the American economy took the name progressive or liberal, giving rise to, for example, the phrase big government liberals. This initially caused confusion because small government and anti-regulatory voices considered themselves traditional liberals, and they took to calling themselves classical liberals to refer to the initial liberalism of the founding. In more recent decades, most of these voices have been categorized as conservative, not in the old European sense, but in the sense of opposing modern political liberals and of being generally anti-statist and more amenable to market forces. They were, Jennifer Delton explains, Jeffersonians, libertarians, Lockeans, but they are now gathered together under the rubric of conservatism. Since the New Deal, the supporters of activist government have embraced the label liberal. Prior to the New Deal era and the pursuit of various activist agendas by political liberals, no coherent conservative movement existed because there had been no major challenge, either liberal or radical, to the nation's basic political principles since the founding. Modern liberals, it should be noted, tend to be more critical of the old traditions and strictures of Christianity, of moral codes more broadly, and of nationalism or patriotic appeals, while modern American conservatives defend them more and tend to be more anti-radical, or, more precisely for the time period covered here, anti-communist. For the purposes of this book, this is our understanding of the American political spectrum and how the terms liberal and conservative will be used. Lastly, we are very much aware that this book leaves much unsaid about politics in the Midwest. It was conceived in the wake of the 2016 election cycle and Republican victories in the region, so it was designed to focus on the longer-term story of conservative forces in the Midwest. To even the score, so to speak, we are planning a second volume focused on liberalism, the Democratic Party, and the left in the Midwest during the same time period covered by this volume, and we hope such a volume will more thoroughly explore the liberal politics of urban areas, university towns, union organizing, prominent liberal leaders and elected officials, various social justice movements, and radicalism. The continuing strength of liberalism and the success of Democratic candidates is what makes the Midwest the last truly competitive battleground region in the United States. And the most important goal of these volumes is to emphasize the unique role of the Midwest as a historically enduring political battleground. In the first chapter, Michael Barone describes the critical moments in the political development of the Midwest. He explains three pivotal dates in Midwestern history, 1787, 1854, and 1937, that have shaped Midwestern culture and attitudes, and can be used to examine the Midwest's role in the 2016 election, and indeed all elections. The Midwest's long-term history reveals which factors contributed to the change in voters' attitudes, what caused their switch from Obama to Trump, and why Midwesterners have voted close to the national average throughout history. Following the surprising results of 2016, Barone argues, the Midwest especially the outstate Midwest, may no longer be ignored by political journalists and taken for granted by Democratic strategists. In Chapter 2, Kyle Condick traces the history of presidential voting patterns in the Midwest from 1976 to 2016, a period bookended by the narrow victories of Jimmy Carter and Donald Trump, two anti-establishment candidates who won the White House thanks in part to crucial victories in key Midwest states. Condick describes state and county-level voting patterns to track changes over the past four decades and assesses how enduring the region's turn toward Trump and the Republicans might be heading into 2020 and beyond. In Chapter 3, Christopher Devine and Daniel Birdsong empirically evaluate the Midwest's status as a presidential battleground in the post-World War II era, 1946 to 2016. Their analysis indicates that the Midwest has remained a major battleground, if not the preeminent one, in modern presidential elections, despite a significant decline in its share of the national population and electoral votes since 1946. The Midwest now has fewer electoral votes than the South and West, whereas it had the most votes until the 1930s. Also, the Midwest no longer hosts nearly all party conventions or has representation on nearly every major party presidential ticket, as was the case prior to 1945. But, when judged by the most direct metrics of battleground status, the Midwest performs very well, if not exceptionally so, in comparison to other regions. For instance, in newspaper coverage of the 1988 to 2016 elections, over one-third, 38% to 57% of the states cited as presidential battlegrounds were located in the Midwest, more than for any other region. During that same period, the presidential campaigns made more visits to the Midwest, 37.3%, than to any other region on average, and in 2012, the Midwest hosted nearly half, 49.7%, of all candidate visits. The Midwest's status as fly-to country for presidential candidates in the post-World War II era is attributable to continued, even increasing, electoral competitiveness, but it is threatened by a steady loss of population and thus electoral votes, as well as demographic and political changes that suggest a potential shift toward the Republican Party. This chapter, therefore, helps to explain why the Midwest will play a critical role in deciding the presidential election in 2020 and beyond. In Chapter 4, Devin Hunter notes how demographers often point to Illinois as the most representative state of the Union in terms of social and political makeup. As such, the legendary divide between metropolitan Chicago and the hinterlands of downstate holds special meaning in understanding the dynamic of urban, non-urban divides of yesterday and today. Hunter's chapter traces the drawn-out struggle to reapportion and redistrict the Illinois State Legislature between 1953 and 1965. In this effort to make the representation in the Illinois General Assembly more proportional to the growth of Chicago and its suburbs, politicians defined and made use of tensions between Chicago, suburban Cook County, the emergent outer suburbs, and the rest of the state. These sentiments often cut across party lines and complicate standard depictions of strictly binary downstate metropolitan rivalries. The factions fell short of compromise in 1964, resulting in the infamous bedsheet ballot, in which all 177 seats of the Illinois House were voted on by a statewide electorate. The reapportionment drama features the ascendant Cook County Democratic machine, helmed by Richard J. Daley and his allies in Springfield, entrenched downstate Democratic leaders, and Republicans that run the gamut from good government reformers to mob-aligned representatives. The Republican Party was not always known for its opposition to abortion, as Anne Marie Wambeka explains in Chapter 5. In the 1970s, Michigan's Republican feminists, who actively participated in a moderate state Republican Party, led the fight for abortion rights in Michigan. As the decade progressed, however, The battle over abortion rights, which had always been political, became increasingly partisan. By 1982, Democrats were strategically aligned with feminists, solidifying the party's support for abortion rights. Anti-abortion conservatives governed the Republican Party, and Republican feminists gradually lost the political foundation from which to pursue their feminist agenda as they struggled to reconcile the two elements at the core of their identity, republicanism and feminism. As each Republican feminist tried to reconcile the conflict in her own way, the party appeared to be making way for a new type of Republican woman. In Chapter 6, Daniel Spillman explores the development of baby boomer conservative intellectuals at the American Spectator, TAS, magazine in Bloomington, Indiana. Created at Indiana University in 1967, TAS was the only campus magazine founded and edited by baby boomer conservatives in the 1960s to develop into a major national conservative opinion journal by the 1980s. Its founder and editor, R. Emmett Tyrrell Jr., was a Midwesterner and an IU student, dismayed at what seemed to him the radical excesses of some of his contemporaries. His magazine attracted a wide array of conservative contributors who disagreed on many issues but shared his anti-radical outlook. The magazine found unlikely allies among a group of disaffected liberal intellectuals, the emerging neoconservatives. Humor, a theatrical instinct, and an aggressive, combative style were crucial ingredients to the magazine's success. TAS attacked, often by name, the local radical student activists, using satire, mockery, and personal attacks, while also publishing a wide range of anti-radicals' opinions on various political and cultural issues. Spillman's chapter explores the early history of this Indiana-based conservative magazine. In A New State of Superior, Political Fracture and Anti-Environmentalism in the Upper Midwest, Camden Bird tracks the political realignments in the Lake Superior mining communities in response to the modern environmental movement of the late 1960s and 1970s. Facing chronic unemployment and a depressed regional economy, many traditional Democratic voters in the Upper Midwest viewed environmental legislation as an assault on their livelihoods. Centering his study on the political rhetoric and efforts of the Democratic Michigan State Representative Dominic Jacobetti, Bird examines how residents' attempts to secede from the state of Michigan marked the beginnings of a political fracture among otherwise stalwart members of FDR's New Deal coalition. Jacobetti and his supporters advocated for complete political autonomy in order to bypass environmental regulations they believed harmed the already depressed mining economy. Though their efforts to form the 51st state ultimately failed, a history of the statehood movement in the Upper Midwest provides important context to understand how economic and environmental debates have served as fracture lines among residents of the Upper Midwest and caused one-time Democrats to move into the Republican camp. In Chapter 8, Jeffrey Bloodworth discusses the roots of Donald Trump's popularity with the industrial Midwest's white working class. This right-wing populist turn, he argues, did not originate in 2016. Rather, President Trump has many historical antecedents. Charlie Stenvig, the three-time mayor of Minneapolis, 1969 to 1973 and 1976 to 1978, and founder of the Working Class Tea Party, is one such progenitor. A policeman and union member, Stenvig capitalized upon the white-hot politics of 1968 and white working-class contempt for elites to win the Minneapolis mayor's office. Disgusted at 1968's rising crime rates, busing for integration, and the anti-war movement, working-class Minneapolitans rejected the establishment and rallied to an utter political novice. Stenvig's Tea Party bears a remarkable resemblance to Trump's style and political philosophy. Libertarian when it came to busing for integration, the Tea Party pushed big government for other white working-class concerns. Inept at governance, Stenvig, along with his base, took an odd pride in his incompetence. Charlie Stenvig helps us understand the president's appeal by explaining how, in the past, the Midwest's white working class has opted for a know-nothing curmudgeon when confronted with a political class that ignores their concerns. In a similar vein, William Russell Coyle examines the career of Republican James Rhodes, 1909 to 2001, the longest-serving governor in Ohio history, in Chapter 9. Rhodes deftly survived decades of political and economic change in a crucial political swing state. The son and grandson of Appalachian coal miners, Rhodes lived through the economic insecurity that characterized early 20th century working-class life, and, in four terms spanning 1962 through 1982, became Ohio's most powerful governor. Often dismissed as a crony capitalist or a sideshow carnival barker, Rhodes drew on his roots in Midwestern coal towns to recast the ideology of Ohio Republicans, dragging them from their anti-New Deal obsessions and toward a populist, if still pro-business, version of working-class economic security. In 1976 and 1977, Rhodes recruited Honda to Ohio. He exploited the emerging, uncertain world economy of the 1970s as he pursued goals that were at once separate, intertwining, and contradictory, spinning leverage from a weak bargaining position by playing German capitalists against Japanese capitalists, pandering to fearful voters for whom the Rust Belt symbolized the decline of white America, creating opportunities for working-class economic security despite the global reordering of industrial production. Rhodes maintained domestic power by helping to globalize the American heartland. Focusing on the conservative takeover of the Republican Party of Iowa, in Chapter 10, Corey Halla questions the extent to which the new right agenda transforms Midwestern conservatism. Exploring the fundraising of groups such as Iowans for Right to Life, the Iowa Farm Bureau, and a collection of legislators and activists called the Conservative Coalition, Halla explains the demise of moderate Republicans loyal to Governor Robert Ray and the rise of conservative Republicans such as Governor Terry Branstad and Senator Charles Grassley. While these conservative Republicans and others like U.S. Senator Roger Jepson won elections that brought conservatives to the pinnacle of Iowa politics, though, the new right lagged behind Democrats in fundraising and winning local elections. In the end, Halla finds, the new right's takeover of the Iowa Republican Party reveals both a regional predilection to social and anti-labor conservatism and also the importance of populist campaigning and flexibility on economic policy required of Midwestern Republicans. Ian Taller Clark's chapter, From the Breweries to the Supermax, explores the rise of carceral populism in metropolitan Milwaukee amid the ongoing urban crisis between 1950 and 2000. This political movement coalesced around a coalition of predominantly white working and middle-class Milwaukeeans from suburban communities and urban neighborhoods. Carceral populists advocated for constructing new prisons, expanding the powers of law enforcement, and stiffening some criminal penalties while also creating new ones. This chapter challenges the view that white ethnics were reactionaries attracted to new rights' message of small government, social conservatism, and opposition to civil rights. Rather, this chapter shows that white Milwaukeeans in debates over juvenile delinquency in the 1950s, prison reform in the 1970s, and prison construction in the 1990s, remade both modern conservatism and post-war liberalism. In Chapter 12, John Lauck explores the momentary surge of support for Democrats in South Dakota during the early 1970s and the rapid reversal of their fortunes. By 1976, new and revived conservative forces in the state had successfully tapped anti-tax, anti-abortion, and anti-crime sentiments and began sweeping Democrats from power and elevating Republicans such as Bill Janklow to the governorship and Larry Pressler to the U.S. Senate. By the end of the decade, the Democrats had lost almost all major offices in the state. The greatest and most symbolic setback for Democrats came with the 1980 defeat of U.S. Senator George McGovern, who had come to represent the liberalism of the 1960s. In Chapter 13, Daniel Rowe examines how municipal and state politicians from the industrial Midwest responded to the overlapping financial and industrial crises of the late 1970s and early 1980s. Shifting the focus away from Ronald Reagan, the conservative movement, and simplistic tales of ideological and partisan realignment, Rowe reveals that at a local and regional level, elected officials seldom embraced the policies that we associate with the decades after the 1960s. In many cases, they vigorously opposed conservative policies, highlighting the friction between Midwestern urban centers and more conservative rural counties. Confronted with a deep economic nosedive, elected officials from the Rust Belt fought against the Reagan administration's spending cuts, proposed policies that would have dramatically increased the federal government's role in economic affairs, and vigorously lobbied for tax increases. In states and cities often portrayed as decisive political battlegrounds and the home of Reagan Democrats, politics during the 1970s and 1980s tilted to the left, especially in urban areas, at least as often as they tilted to the right. The urban-rural differential is explored in greater detail by Zachary Michael Jack in Chapter 14. The election of Trump in 2016, Jack notes, sent geodemographic experts across the country back to their drawing boards, seeking new visual metaphors for a nation whose differences could no longer be explained in conventional terms. Increasingly, broad-brush analyses of red versus blue states failed to adequately describe dynamic regional differences in the newly red Upper Midwest, in particular, where progressive counties, playing host to influential innovation hubs such as Iowa City, Iowa, Madison, Wisconsin, and Rochester, Minnesota, often existed a mere 30 miles or less from Trump strongholds otherwise held in their ideological orbit. In Red Rogues Orbit Blue Stars, Jack posits a set of new astropolitical laws governing the geopolitical entropy of the Trump-era Upper Midwest. In another chapter focused on a Midwestern governor, A. James Fuller interprets the gubernatorial career of Mitch Daniels of Indiana. In Chapter 15, Fuller argues that Daniels led the way for other Republican governors in the Midwest who spearheaded the conservative revolution in the region in the early 21st century, and also contends that Daniels laid the groundwork for Donald Trump's presidential campaign in 2016. Adopting a pragmatic style that coupled the forces of market capitalism with a lean and efficient state government, Daniels won widespread praise for his economic policies, even as critics questioned whether his success was real and blasted him for not addressing other problems in the state. By the midpoint of the Trump administration, many conservative commentators lamented that Daniels had not pursued the presidency, but his real legacy was found in the way that he forged the model adopted by other Republican governors across the Midwest. In Chapter 16, Catherine McNicol Stock uses the construction of the Ralph Engelstad Arena at the University of North Dakota to shed light on the promise and peril inherent in fiscal conservatism, a key element of the new conservatism. Despite a generation of dominance in Bismarck, the special election of 1989 and subsequent gubernatorial election of 1992 spelled the end of Democratic nonpartisan league rule. Voters first rejected new taxes, then rejected the DNPL altogether. The new political culture that grew under consecutive Republican administrations combined cultural conservatism with the embrace of large out-of-state corporations and wealthy individuals. The best-known example of this new conservatism at work in the state is the development of the fracking industry in western North Dakota. But it can also be seen, even heralded, 250 miles east of the Bakken and 15 years earlier at the University of North Dakota's Ralph Engelstad Arena. Engelstad, an alum of UND who made his fortune in the casino business, spared no expense to create a world-class hockey arena. Most North Dakotans had never seen anything like it. And yet the story of Ralph's Palace is also a cautionary tale. With state revenues down in the 1980s and 1990s, UND officials had little choice but to accept Engelstad's historic gift and give in to his monopolistic demands, including his threat that, should the university change the controversial Fighting Sioux mascot, he would halt construction and let the building rot. In the end, his views and his actions impacted far more than just a hockey team. He proved a model going forward of the political and cultural authority that private wealth will bring to the state, no matter how it was made or what it demands of its recipients. One of the most defining features of the late 20th century culture wars, as Chad Kinsella explains, was the electoral and legal battles over same-sex marriage. Starting in the late 1990s and lasting until the Obergefell versus Hodges 2015 decision, several states, including in the Midwest, passed same-sex marriage bans. In Chapter 17, Kinsella examines state votes that occurred in the Midwest that banned, or, as in the case of Minnesota, attempted to ban same-sex marriage up until the Supreme Court ruled such bans unconstitutional. Elections are analyzed in order of the year they occurred, with county maps of the results provided. Furthermore, the analysis provides an examination of the relationship between support and opposition to same-sex marriage and partisanship via the partisan vote at the top of the ticket for each state. Findings from this chapter will highlight support and opposition for gay rights in the Midwest, as well as the political and social context of this major culture war battle and its implications. This volume would not have been possible without the leadership, guidance, and patience of Kim Hoagland at the University Press of Kansas. Kim was always quick with a reply, eager to help, and generous with her time as her frantic editors attempted to make the necessary deadlines that would allow this book to be released before the 2020 election. Our greatest appreciation is extended to Kim for all of her insights and forbearance, and to David Congdon for taking everything across the finish line. We also must thank Gleaves Whitney and Scott St. Louis of the Howenstein Center at Grand Valley State University, who annually host the Midwestern History Association Conference, where they allowed us to host panels on this topic, recruit contributors, and generally work out the dimensions of this project. This volume is dedicated to the great historian Howard Lamar of Yale University, who helped us both on our journeys with great enthusiasm and wisdom. 1. The Surprising New Political Battleground, The Midwest, Michael Barone. Much to the surprise of cephalogists, the fancy word for election watchers, the key votes in the 2016 presidential election were cast in the Midwest. Not by Hispanics in the Sunbelt or young techies in newly fashionable gentrified neighborhoods in Silicon Valley, Brooklyn, or Austin, but by white non-college graduates in the counties outside million-plus metropolitan areas in the Midwest. Of the 100 electoral votes that switched from Democratic in 2012 to Republican in 2016, 50 were in the Midwest, Ohio, Michigan, Wisconsin, and Iowa, and 20 more were in Pennsylvania, specifically west of Metro Philadelphia, which, demographically and attitudinally, more closely resembles the Midwest than the rest of the Northeast. In addition, 29 more were in Florida, where the key Obama to Trump movement came in small counties along the Gulf Coast and north of Orlando, heavily inhabited by former Midwesterners. And the one additional Democratic to Republican electoral vote was that of the 2nd Congressional District of Maine, a North Woods area resembling the Upper Peninsula of Michigan or the North Woods of Wisconsin and Minnesota. To paraphrase the British tabloid The Sun, which headlined the Conservatives' surprise 1992 win with, "It's the Sun what won it," in 2016, it was the Midwest what won it. The standard analysis of this is that significant numbers of white non-college graduates nationally shifted from Obama to Trump, and that those voters were concentrated in the Midwest. That is right as far as it goes. But history also has its claims, and it can affect voters' attitudes, often almost invisibly, for many years and decades afterward. I want to look at the Midwest's history to explain this unexpected turn of events, and not just to understand why white, non-college graduate Midwesterners switched from Obama to Trump in 2016, but also to understand why such an unusually high percentage of them, compared to the national average, voted for Obama in 2008 and 2012, and why Midwesterners have voted as they have, close to but not identical to the national average, throughout history. Three pivotal dates in Midwestern history, extreme events, as I call them, for what is in retrospect their unusual nature, have shaped Midwestern culture and attitudes. They are 1787, 1854, and 1937. Each is far distant to us, 230, 163, and 80 years ago. Only a few 2016 Midwestern voters were alive for the most recent of these, and almost none grew up with parents who were alive during the second. I add that almost caveat because I am aware that the house of President John Tyler, born in 1790, is currently owned by one of his two living grandsons. Tyler was a Virginia planter and slaveholder, not at all a Midwesterner, but he was the vice presidential nominee on the Tippecanoe and Tyler II Whig ticket that carried the Midwest in 1840. History is closer to us than we usually think. The first date I mentioned, 1787, is usually remembered as the year in which the Constitutional Convention met. But the extreme event I am referring to is another one, when the Confederation Congress passed the Northwest Ordinance on July 13, 1787, while the convention was in session down the street in Philadelphia. Modified under criticism by George...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.